The engines were all happily getting on with their jobs and the weather began to grow colder. Leaves began falling from the trees as autumn grasped the railway, causing some struggle while the engines slipped on them as they tackled line gradients. All of the engines were feeling positive, except for one. Eddie had begun to grow distant with the rest of the fleet, and Turbo was concerned.
Do you think Eddie's all right?
He's probably fine, probably just feeling a bit tired lately. He hasn't been working night shifts, after all.
I don't think that's bothering him.
What are you on about?
He was crying the other night. I overheard him talking to his crew, telling them he was alone.
What? He's not alone. He's got us.
Maybe he wants a girlfriend?
Nah, he's practically married to Colin, isn't he? Ah, hang on. I think I know what this is all about. Do enlighten me, 257. Don't you remember the conversation we had the other day? I can hardly remember what happened this morning. We were discussing our relatives, and who had survived into preservation. I think Eddie means that he's alone in preservation. I mean, 2251 classes haven't been seen on the mainline for years.
That's true. I've never seen one on my travels.
Well, I'm sure he'll come round to the idea of being alone eventually. Trust you to be sympathetic. I'm being honest.
Be careful. Here he comes.
Eddie slunk into the sheds, looking miserable. Turbo tried to welcome him back.
Hello, Eddie. Are you okay? Had a good day.
What do you care?
Just trying to make conversation.
Well, maybe I don't want conversation. Turbo looked upset. 257 stepped in. Look, Eddie, whatever's rattled your smoke box lately, don't take it out on Turbo. Oh, don't you start as well. Just leave me alone, the lot of you. And with that, he steamed away again.
I was only trying to be nice.
I know, Turbo. Don't worry about it. I'll be speaking to Mr. Dark about this. And he did. He's being snappy with everyone. He's always grumpy in the sheds, and he looks miserable, sir. I have noticed that myself. According to his crew, he's steaming badly too, and is awfully grouchy. They told me he thinks he's alone in preservation, which just isn't true. 257 was surprised. He's not alone? No, there is another 2251 class in existence, and it's being preserved as well. I wonder if... Yes, I will. And without further explanation, Mr. Dark hurried away, leaving 257 slightly confused. A week later, Mr. Dark spoke to Eddie in the sheds. Eddie, I'd like you to go to the junction this morning, please. Light engine. I have a surprise for you.
Oh, all right, sir.
Cheer up. I think you'll like it.
Eddie moped off down to the junction, expecting to find something rather mediocre waiting for him. But as he rolled towards the sheds, he noticed something that took his breath away. Waiting in the sheds, looking radiant in Great Western colours, was another member of his class. As he got closer, he noticed the number and nearly jumped off the rails in shock. 3205? Ellie, is that you?
Eddie, it's been such a long time since I last saw you. Still wearing that ugly black livery then?
But how? I thought you'd been scrapped, like everyone else.
Nope, I was saved by a society. I was taken to the Dart Valley Railway for a few years. I'm on my way to the Severn Valley Railway, actually. Budget Control asked my owners if I could come and see you first. I didn't know another 2251 had survived either. But I'm glad it was you.
Wow. So I'm not alone. And my favourite sister survived. This is brilliant.
I'm glad you're happy. Your controller said you'd been depressed lately since you thought you were alone in preservation.
I was. But I feel much better knowing I'm not.
Oh, good. So, how has life been treating you? How did you end up in the southern region, then? And are you still in contact with that Maxon?
The two Great Western engines spent the rest of the morning catching up with one another and learning what they'd both been up to since they last met, which was back in the 50s. Around lunchtime, the yard foreman came over.
Right, you two. There's a good train coming in shortly. Can I ask you two to take it to the industrial estate, please, if you're quite finished talking?
Yes, sir.
Oh, yes. Come on. Let's go. Me in front.
Hey!
The two engines grabbed the train and hurried up the line, passing a bemused Brian at Wallchurch, who swore that he was getting double vision and decided that he might need glasses. They soon descended into the industrial estate, where Colin was refuelling. Eddie and Ellie came over to him. Hi, Colin.
Hello, Eddie. And who's this lovely lady, then?
I'm Ellie, Eddie's sister.
How very nice to meet you.
The two engines smiled at each other. In those few seconds, a spark seemed to fly between them, which wasn't surprising, seeing as Colin is quite capable of throwing sparks out of his chimney when working hard. Oh, wait, no, I mean, a spark of attraction. Sorry, back to the story. Anyway, Colin, we might need your help this afternoon. It seems there's a few trains going to the junction. Is that all right with you?
Of course it is.
He grinned at Ellie, who grinned back. Eddie saw nothing. He was too busy watching a kestrel overhead. Colin, Eddie and Ellie worked hard all afternoon shifting trains over the branch line. As the sun began to set, the three engines retired to the junction, reflecting on their day.
Ugh, what a day. Yeah, I never thought we'd get those tankers out of the gasworks.
It's all thanks to me.
Nah, it's my doing. Nah, you're both deluded. It was me.
They laughed. Colin looked over at Ellie again, who was staring at him. She hastily looked away, and they all carried on speaking well into the night. Over the next few weeks, they worked together on the goods traffic, enjoying themselves greatly. However, Ellie soon began to grow tired of Eddie's conversations, which were all boring, dull stories about himself and what he had been doing. Ellie tried to intervene and tell him about her adventure too, but he wouldn't listen. Colin, on the other hand, was very interested in her stories, and she was interested in his too. They were beginning to get rather close. One evening, Eddie was boring the pair of them about shunting moves at Wallchurch when the yard foreman came over again. Eddie, I'm very sorry to disturb you, but an emergency has arisen at Mearcombe, and I'm going to have to ask you to head up there right away.
Oh, great. I'm talking to this lot. Can't Colin go?
I've been asked to send you especially. Sorry.
Oh, fine, geez. I'll be back later on, you two.
Eddie steamed away. Ellie looked relieved.
He's boring my axle boxes off.
Why can't he talk about something more interesting? He's not like you. You always make me laugh.
You make me laugh too. Colin?
Yeah?
Do you, well, I wanted to ask if you might, perhaps, I don't know if I can tell you.
You can tell me if you want to. I'll listen.
His smile reassured her.
Well, over the last few weeks, I've been, well, thinking.
Oh?
I've been thinking about you. I think that I like you. Rather a lot.
Colin blushed.
Really?
Ellie blushed as well.
Oh, I'm so sorry. I know I shouldn't have said anything. It's probably just me being silly. But you're not like other guys I know. You actually listen to me. You actually care about what I have to say, and...
Ellie, it's all right. I think I like you too.
You do?
Like I said, you make me laugh. Nobody else does it better. And it doesn't help that you're rather attractive too.
He blushed again. Ellie grinned sheepishly.
So, what does this mean for us then?
Well, I know this is a bit forward, but do you want to go out with me?
Oh, of course I want to, silly!
But...
There's a but?
Don't tell Eddie. He'd do his regulator in.
All right. We'll keep it a secret. Just between us, then.
And with that, the two engines snuggled down for the night, smiling and grinning at each other. For a while afterwards, Colin and Ellie stayed very close to each other and often tried to find secluded places around the line to spend time together, where Eddie wouldn't be able to find them. This carried on for a while, but then it all fell down. One afternoon, a few weeks after Colin and Ellie had expressed their liking for each other, Eddie happened to arrive at Soma with a goods train, where Lino was chatting with Fear and Otto. It was most unfortunate that Lino didn't see Eddie rolling up towards them.
Colin asked me not to tell Eddie anything about it. He'd go nuts if he found out. Found out what, Lino?
Lino jumped about 5 miles north.
Oh, nothing, nothing.
You said that Colin didn't want me to know something?
Oh, well, you see.
Eddie rolled right up to the little old tank engine.
Tell me, or I'll dismantle your dome.
Lino stared at Eddie. Deciding that he'd rather keep his dome intact, he told Eddie what he knew.
So what you're saying is, Ellie and Colin are having a secret relationship?
Yes.
Right. I think I need a word with my dear friend.
And with that, he abandoned his train and zoomed out of Soma.
I shouldn't have said anything.
Do you think? Colin was resting at the junction when Eddie arrived. Eddie stopped in front of him, looking shifty. Colin felt nervous. Had he and Ellie already been rumbled?
Hello, my good friend.
Hi. I just wanted a quick word with you.
Yes?
Have you and Ellie been seeing each other without telling me? Because I'd really like...
Well, yes. We have been seeing each other, Eddie. I'm sorry. I wanted to tell you, but I was frightened.
No, Colin, really, that's fine. I just wish you'd have told me.
Really?
Yeah. I think it's a great idea. You two would be great together. Whew! For a moment there, I thought you just jumped in and slept with her.
Colin looked extremely guilty.
You haven't slept with her, have you?
Well, you see, the thing is, Eddie,
you slept with my sister? You've barely known her 5 minutes and you sleep with her? It wasn't like that. I bet you just wanted some young great Western engine to have rumpy pumpy with, didn't you? Didn't you?
Eddie, we...
How bloody dare you?
Eddie, what are you doing?
Ellie, is this all true? Have you been sleeping with Colin of all engines? Colin?
Eddie, we're sorry. We love each other.
It's true. Bull, you two don't even know what love is.
Neither do you. Just because you've never had a girlfriend and you've never slept with anybody.
That's a lie. How would you know? We haven't even seen each other for years. I won't let you two do this. I...
Shut up, Eddie. You know nothing. You don't own me. You don't control me. I'm my own person and I'm quite old enough to decide what I want to do myself. Colin is too, so leave him alone.
Eddie went dumbfounded. Right. Fine.
Eddie?
Don't speak to me, either of you.
But...
I wish you'd never come here. And he bounced away.
Colin, I'm so sorry about this.
It's not your fault. It's mine.
It isn't.
I instigated this. I asked you out.
We both wanted it and you know it.
I know. But what are we going to do now?
I have an idea. Come with me.
The two engines headed up to Mirkoom. Eddie rolled into the sheds at the other end of the line. Only Cameron and Dave were present.
What's wrong, Eddie? That slut of a sister of mine, and that traitor of a friend, Colin, too.
Wait, what? What's happened?
They've been sleeping together for weeks. They reckon they're in love. How can they be? They hardly know each other. And she's my sister. How dare she not tell me?
Cameron thought for a minute. Calm down, Eddie. Calm down. Ellie's at perfect liberty to date or sleep with whoever she wants, as is Colin. And if they're happy together, then why should you ruin it for them? This is probably the reason they didn't tell you. They knew you'd overreact. But, excuse me for a moment, chaps. I need to vomit.
Listen to me, Eddie. You better think about your actions and apologise to them, and soon, before...
But before he could finish, Raymond backed in.
Oh, Eddie, I'm glad I found you. I've just seen Colin and Ellie.
So what?
They're leaving.
Eddie was taken aback.
Leaving? What do you mean?
Ellie just spoke to Mr. Dark, asking if she could continue to the Seven Valley. She said she'd had enough, and Colin's apparently going with her.
You see, Eddie, you'd better go and make amends, or you may never get another chance to, and leave both of them.
You're right. Oh my God, I'd better go. And he stormed away.
At Gallon Junction, Ellie and Colin were ready to leave. They were waiting for Turbo to refuel so that he could take them up to Kidderminster, which Mr. Dark had now just agreed to.
Are you sure you want to come with me, Colin? What about the dark railway?
They'll manage without me. If we can't be together around Eddie, then I'd rather be with you somewhere else.
Oh. Well, Turbo looks ready. We'd better...
Suddenly, there was a loud whistle, and Eddie stormed in. Wait!
We're not interested. And you can't change our minds. We're going.
I don't want to change your minds. I just want to apologize before you go. I overreacted. I realize that now. I shouldn't have said what I said, or done what I did. Can you both find it in your heart to forgive me?
Well, Colin, what do you think?
He is your brother, and he is my best friend. I do forgive you, Eddie. And I'm sorry I didn't let you know. I should have. It's okay, old friend.
I think I can forgive you too. You're the only brother I have now. It's too bad you can't come with us.
Actually, I've just spoken to Mr. Dark as well. He said that if you two want me to go, I can come with you. Both myself and Colin on loan, of course. Really?
We'd love you to. The three of us romping over the Severn Valley. That will be fun.
So, it's all right then? Of course!
Yeah!
Turbo was ready. The three engines were coupled up behind him, and once the signal had changed, Turbo proceeded out of the yard with them, heaving off towards the Severn Valley Railway, where, hopefully, Colin, Eddie and Ellie could start a new adventure.